Okie doke, Chapter 4. Southern Sudan, 2008. Naya's mother took the plastic container from her and emptied the water into three large jars. She handed Naya a bowl of boiled sugan meal and poured a little milk over it. Naya sat outside in the shade of the house and ate, and when she was done, she took the bowl back inside. Her mother was nursing the baby. Naya's little brother, take Easter with you, her mother said, nodding towards Naya's sister. Glancing at her younger sister, Naya did not know what she was thinking. That Iker was only 5 years old and was too small and weak and walked too slowly. She needs to learn, her mother said. Naya nodded. She picked up a plastic container and took Iker by the hand. Horn for just home just long enough to eat. Naya would now make up her second trip to the pond. To the pond and back, to the pond and back. Nearly a full day of walking altogether. This was Naya's daily routine 7 months of the year. Daily. That means every single day. Southern Sudan, 1985. Salva held his breath as he scanned the faces one by one. Then the air left his lungs and seemed to take all hope with it. Strangers, no one from his family. The old woman came up behind him and greeted the group. "Where are you going?" she asked. A few people exchanged uneasy glances, and there was no reply. The woman put her hand on Salva's shoulder. "This one is alone. Will you take him with you?" Salva saw doubt on the people's faces, and several men at the front of the group began speaking to each other. "He's a child. He will slow us down. Another mouth to feed. It's already hard enough to find food. He's young and too young to do any work, and he'll definitely be no help to us." Salva hung his head. They would leave him behind again, just like the others. But then a woman in the group reached out and touched the arm of one of the men. She said nothing, but looked at the man and then at Salva. The man nodded and turned to the group. "We will take him," he said. Salva looked up quickly, and a few in the group were shaking their heads and grumbling. The man shrugged. "He is Dinka," he said, and began walking again. The old woman gave Salva a bag of peanuts and a gourd for drinking water. He thanked her and said goodbye. Then he caught up with the group, determined not to lag behind, not to complain, not to be any trouble to anyone. He did not even ask where they were going for fear that this question would be unwelcome. He knew only that they were Dinka and they were trying to stay away from war. He had to be content with that. The days became a never-ending walk. Salva's feet kept time with the thoughts in his head, the same words over and over. "Where is my family? Where is my family?" Every day he woke and walked with the group, rested at midday, and walked again till dark. They slept on the ground, and the terrain changed from scrub to woodland as they walked among strands of stunted trees. There was little to eat, a few fruits here and there, but always either unripe or worm-rotted. Salva's peanuts were gone by the end of the third day, and after about a week, they were joined by another group of Dinka. Several members of the tribe called Jurchul, men and women, boys and girls, young and old, walking, 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 walking to nowhere. Salva had never been so hungry. He stumbled along, somehow moving one foot in front of the other, not noticing the ground. He walked on, or the forest around him, or the light of day. Nothing was real except his hunger. Once a hollow in his stomach was now a deep buzzing pain in every part of him. Usually he walked among the Dinka, but today, shuffling along in the days, he found he had fallen a little behind. Walking next to him was a young man from Jurlan. Salva didn't know much about him, except his name was Buska. As they walked along, Buska slowed down, and Salva wondered sluggishly if they shouldn't try to keep up a little bit better. Just then, Buska stopped walking. Salva stopped too, but he was too weak and hungry to ask why they were standing still. Buska cocked his head and furrowed his brow, listening. They stood motionless for several moments, and Salva could hear the noise of the rest of the group ahead of them. A few faint voices, birds calling somewhere in the trees. He strained his ears. What was that? Jet plane bombs? Was it gunfire getting closer instead of farther away? Salva's fear began to grow until it was stronger than his hunger. And then, a slow smile spread across Buska's face. There, you hear? Salva frowned and shook his head. Yes, there it is. Come. Buska began walking very quickly, and Salva struggled to keep up. Twice Buska paused to listen, then going even faster. What? Salva started to ask. Buska stopped abruptly in front of a very large tree. Yes, he said. Now go call the others. By now, Salva had caught the feeling of excitement. But what shall I tell them? The bird, the one I was listening to, he led me right here. Buska's smile was bigger now. You see that? He pointed up at the branches of the tree. A beehive, a fine large one. Salva hurried off to call the rest of the group and had heard of this, that the Jurchul would follow the call of the bird called the honey guide, but he had never seen it done before. Honey, this would be a feast.